What is fifth dimensional consciousness? Connie was born and raised in Oklahoma City and has lived there most of her life. And in 1972, she met her spiritual teacher, Audley Allison, with whom she studied meditation until he passed away in 1988. As she describes, Audley was one of those rare individuals who had mastered a deep understanding of the spiritual aspects of life and of himself. And he was able to touch others and share with them those higher frequencies that activate our ability to see and touch the God within and develop what is now being called fifth dimensional consciousness. During her talk, Connie will attempt to answer this question and will share 16 fifth dimensional traits, abilities, and perspectives on life that she has gleaned from her time with Audley and the Oracle Google. Take it away, Connie.
Okay, hi everyone. It's really a pleasure to be here, and it was even a greater pleasure to have the opportunity to present and create this presentation. To start with, I'm going to do the meditation as well as the talk. And the meditation is a mantra meditation. It is in Sanskrit, and it lasts 6 minutes. You'll need to concentrate pretty hard, or your mind is going to wander because it seems to go on forever without real intense concentration. You can, and the video will explain it. What I did was I rehearsed it, my whole presentation, so that I could make sure I didn't run too long, and I recorded it so that I could have an exact time. So I liked the recording well enough, and don't really want to try to do a repeat of it. So I'm just going to share the recording. So I won't see you again in person until the meditation and the talk is over.
Today's meditation will consist of a mantra that's repeated over and over and over again, and some animated mandalas. So you can approach this one of two ways, or more than one of two ways. You can concentrate on the mandala while you listen to the mantra, or repeat it, the mantra in your head or out loud. You can close your eyes and concentrate in your heart, at the top of your head, it's your pineal gland, or feel your aura all around you. Run the energy through your body, starting at the top of the head, running it all the way through your body and out your feet while you listen to or chant the mantra. So that's what the meditation is going to be. This particular mantra I got off of the video documentary, the film Inner Worlds, Outer Worlds by Daniel Schmidt. And so that inspired this. I took his song from the movie, part of it, and I married it to some animations that I found on YouTube. So that's what the meditation's gonna be. There are several bija seed mantras in this mantra that I'm going to show you. It consists of various classic phrases used in Sanskrit mantras, which express the fundamental principles that make creation possible. It's known as Lord Ganesha's Mool Mantra, and its design was designed 3,000 years ago to help remove obstacles to success within the inner and outer worlds. Mantras help still the mind for meditation by enabling the practitioner to focus, and that's the main purpose of what we're going to do here, is for you to concentrate and bring your awareness into a focus.
Om Shreem Reem Kleem Lam Gam Ganapatiye Varavaradav Saravajanam Meva Shabha. Shreem Reem Kleem Lam Gam Ganapati Varavaradav Saravajanam Meva Shabha. Narada Sarva Janam Eva Shamaya Swaha.
So, the talk today is an exploration of the question, what is fifth dimensional consciousness? The term fifth dimensional consciousness has been floating around for a while. The idea has been floating around for a while. It's gotten a lot more popular, a lot more attention lately. And so I'm going to kind of explore that question. What is fifth dimensional consciousness? How does human consciousness evolve? Well, they say in a spiral. And this image illustrates that a lot of different aspects of, there are a lot of different aspects to human consciousness. So it's definitely got a lot of room to grow in a lot of different areas. So how do we acquire values, knowledge, and skills? We've learned that. We have discovered that a person who is learning will pay attention and listen attentively with respect to what is being explored or learned. The next level, that's the first thing that has to happen, okay? The next thing that has to happen is the individual has to actively respond and becomes engaged in the learning process, whatever that process might be, a conversation. There does have to be like give and take, like a Q&A, you know, sort of thing going on, inquiry. They have to then place a value on what it is that they're acquiring, a behavior, an idea, getting to know a person, a situation. They have to place value on that before they move to the next level, which is they're going to have to prioritize values and resolve conflicts between them once this new value gets put into their paradigm. And then if they move beyond that with it, they internalize the value and it begins to control their behavior in some way or another. They're the poster child for whatever this particular aspect of life is. Generosity, ambition, just any number of things. Also, in terms of developments, evolution, this movement up the ladder, so to speak, a man named Kohlberg has defined stages of what he called moral development. The first stage is acting to avoid punishment. The second stage is acting to further one's own self-interest. You can see three, meeting the expectations of others so they'll think you're a good boy or a good girl. Upholding laws to meet societal expectations. That's that law and order mentality. Stage five, personal values used to achieve social consciousness, the social contract theory. And the last one is self-selection of universal moral principles. So Kohlberg saw that individuals would move through these stages, hopefully as they mature through life. Some people never do move all the way up through stage six. He did in fact say that is the least common, smallest number of people in society have actually reached stage six. But that's interesting, you know, I can see that playing out. In the different drum, he's going to talk about, we're going to look at what he says society and individuals go through, another series of developmental stages, that spiral, that where there's progress, then regress, and progress and regress, and progress and regress in these different stages. So you'll be in one maybe 20% of the time, and then in another 40% of the time. So you don't necessarily always, if you're really, really advanced in his stages there, you know, you would be in the final stage all the time, but that's not common. So these are the stages, starting at the bottom with chaotic, antisocial, stage two, formal, institutional, stage three, skeptic, individual, and stage four, mystic, and we'll hear more about the details now. Stage one, chaotic, antisocial. People behaving at this stage of development are pretending to be something they are not. They lack authenticity. They wear masks of kindness, of caring, of support, but only to get something from others, to get what they want. They are con artists in criminal or non-criminal terms. They are looking out for themselves. Stage two, formal, institutional. People behaving at this stage of development approach life from an I am right, you're wrong way of thinking. They know it all and will accept only those people into their lives who agree with them. They embrace dogma and have a need to convert others into their way of thinking. They cluster in groups of like-minded others, rejecting anyone who holds a different view. Stage three, skeptic, individual. People behaving at this stage of development question the status quo. They seek to understand the world around them. They take a somewhat scientific approach to life. They search for evidence and proof to help them define what is real. Stage four, mystic, communal. People behaving at this stage of development are open-minded explorers, fascinated by the mysteries of life. They live and let live. They embrace unity and diversity, feeling the connectedness of all things, and exist in a non-judgmental, non-duality state of unconditional love.
The Pythagorean philosopher Plato hinted enigmatically that there was a golden key that unified all of the mysteries of the universe. It is this golden key that we will return to time and again throughout our exploration. The golden key is the intelligence of the Logos, the source of the primordial Om. One could say that it is the mind of God. With our limited senses, we are observing only the outer manifestation of the hidden mechanics of self-similarity. The source of this divine symmetry is the greatest mystery of our existence. Many of history's monumental thinkers, such as Pythagoras, Kepler, Leonardo da Vinci, Tesla, and Einstein, have come to the threshold of the mystery. Einstein said, "The most beautiful thing we can experience is the mysterious. It is the source of all true art and science. He to whom this emotion is a stranger, who can no longer pause to wonder and stand wrapped in awe, is as good as dead. His eyes are closed."
Listen, the FBI has used psychics before, as have other law enforcement agencies, whether they admit to it or not.
Thank you for destroying any confidence I had in public safety.
Listen, what is your criteria for this categorical dismissal of parapsychological phenomena?
Reality.
Oh, yes, reality. What would that be? Newtonian reality, Einsteinian reality, quantum reality? This for the two of us.
Larry, you cannot go about defending this as science.
Listen, two University of Chicago studies have presented evidence that the human brain is still evolving. Two key brain-building genes are undergoing rapid mutation. So what if unique perceptual abilities arose, just a simple genetic variant?
Larry, first of all, I'm well aware of those studies, okay? I might very well incorporate some of that data into my cognitive emergence work.
But you're suggesting that this guy Kraft is somehow higher evolved than the rest of us.
What if the human brain has reached a point where it is sensitive on a subatomic level, a level where matter can appear and disappear, where time can run backwards or forwards? I mean, who's to say what's possible, what isn't possible?
What flavor of crazy Kool-Aid do they make you drink when you join the physics department?
Okay. So, how does the human brain evolve? Okay, what activates human brain development? Is it our daily routine, our new experiences, our culture, our technological development, crises, obviously all of the above, the golden key, there's stuff there we don't even know about. So we're going to compare and contrast what is considered third dimensional consciousness to fifth dimensional consciousness for the rest of this talk. As a fifth dimensional being, you embrace rigid beliefs characterized by polarity such as right, wrong, good, evil, rich, poor, victim, victimizer, or feminine, masculine. As a fifth dimensional being, you experience a sense of oneness and feel the primordial unity of all that is. As a third dimensional being, you struggle with life, resist opportunities to learn, change, and evolve, clinging to disappointment and the pain and suffering it causes. As a fifth dimensional being, you integrate the lessons of life quickly without resistance, pain, or struggle. As a third dimensional being, you allow fear to control and hinder you from pursuing your inner calling, your dreams and goals. You use fear as an excuse to avoid growth and change. As a fifth dimensional being, you are no longer ruled by fear at the conscious or subconscious level. As a third dimensional being, you have chakras that are misaligned, out of balance, over or underactive, and distorted. As a fifth dimensional being, you have chakras that are balanced and operate in harmony. As a third dimensional being, you relinquish control to authorities such as religious leaders, political leaders, doctors, scientists, including family and friends, as well as to cultural and societal expectations. As a fifth dimensional being, you operate from inner guidance or intuition. As a third dimensional being, you view every aspect of life as disconnected individual elements to be evaluated and judged, seeing self as separate and isolated. As a fifth dimensional being, you live with the awareness that everything is connected, and you can see how your thoughts affect others and how others' thoughts affect you. As a third dimensional being, you assume the need to personally control the unfolding of life and the behavior of others, rigidly controlling even yourself. As a fifth dimensional being, you surrender control of thoughts to actions and actions to God, whatever you want to call God. As a third dimensional being, you feel there is a limited supply of possibilities for which you must compete. As a fifth dimensional being, you know that all you need for soul growth is being supplied. As a third dimensional being, you reject the idea that consciousness is the sixth sense, and accept as real only what can be seen, heard, or touched. As a fifth dimensional being, you understand that consciousness is non-physical, and there is more to reality than what we see, hear, or touch. As a third dimensional being, you see every aspect of life as potentially dangerous, something to be feared, including the giving and receiving of love. As a fifth dimensional being, you realize the only choice you have is to emanate love or fear, emanate fear. As a third dimensional being, you routinely judge, criticize, find fault, and demand compliance from others, as well as from the situation life offers. As a fifth dimensional being, you allow everyone to be as they are and learn from whatever life brings. As a third dimensional being, you view mankind and yourself as less than, unworthy, undeserving, limited human beings, incapable of grasping the divine. as a fifth dimensional being, you understand that you have unlimited access to meaningful insights and amazing experiences through the right use of heart mind. As a third dimensional being, you experience life as a series of struggles, disappointments, random events that must be manipulated and controlled. As a fifth dimensional being, you experience life as the unfolding of a perfectly designed and orchestrated grand plan, governed by archetypal fractal patterns and laws. As a third dimensional being, you have an energy field that is often blocked, resistant, conflicted, distorted by anger, resentment, greed, fear, etc. As a fifth dimensional being, you have an energy field that is free-flowing, a health-generating expression of unconditional love.
I don't want it to be over.
It was great fun. It was great fun to create that. And I have to say, inspired in large part by Daniel Schmidt, who I happened to spend some time with on Zoom this Saturday morning. He is a remarkable young man who lives in Ottawa, Canada, teaches meditation, has a group and a retreat center. Wow, you know.
We are incredibly grateful, and I just feel blessed to have you in our community, Connie. Your generosity of time, of wisdom, of your whole spirit, of learning, teaching yourself, learning from others, and then sharing and teaching is one of those goals, and you have the agency to achieve those goals. Your technical skills rock also.
Well, I tell you what, they're improving every day because I'm so engaged by these presentations. Thank God for Zoom, you know, and the pandemic, I'm sorry to say.
Yeah, thank God for Zoom. So also thank God for the Morningstar amazing band, because they never let us down. They always rise to the occasion. And at this point, I want to turn it over to Frank. Okay, Frank, take it away.
When the moon is in the seventh hour, aligns with Mars, then peace will guide the planets, and love will steer the stars.
This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius, age of Aquarius.
This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius.